Okay. Marjorie, thank you very much. Happy birthday. And a refuah shlema for Sheila, as well as all those who are ill. Well, thank you for inviting me back for what I hope will be an interesting discussion of a practice known as kaparos. Actually, before we get into that, I will note that I have a series of classes starting in November at Beth Emeth, and the topic is life after death. It is a 6-part series. There is a fee for it of $10 per session. If anybody wants more information, you can just email me. My email address is on the sheets. Okay. So, kaparos. How many people here know what kaparos is? Okay. How many people here have actually seen it? Okay, so we have some experienced kaparo shluggers, as the line goes. Shlugging kaparos. For those who have not seen this done, we're going to give a little bit of detail, but yes, it basically what happens is in the run-up to Yom Kippur, it involves taking a live chicken. Not everyone uses a chicken, not everyone uses something alive, we'll talk about that. Swing it around your head, not swing it, don't think like dramatic lasso cowboy thing. But preferably holding it like by the wings, because apparently that's the way you hold a live chicken. And yeah, that's apparently the way to immobilize it. What?
Always wrapped in a towel.
Wrapped in a towel?
Yeah.
Seriously?
My father would have it. He wrapped it in a towel. Yeah. And put it over each of the children.
Got it. So moving it over the head, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and he had certain words that he said while doing it, right?
This way we didn't get any, poo on our head.
This is a good point. You gotta plan ahead. Thank you for the tip. So, I received an email in advance of Rosh Hashanah 2 years ago, and I brought it for you here on the sheet, source number one, by a rabbi who is agitating for the end of the practice of kaparos. And he writes, "Thankfully, most of the Jewish community has come to realize that this practice is inhumane and has no place in our religion. For this reason, it has been essentially banned in 3 major Israeli cities, Tel Aviv, Petah Tikva, and Rishon LeZion. And leading Orthodox rabbis such as Rabbi Shlomo Aviner, Rabbi Yitzhak Haduri, Rabbi David Rosen, Rabbi Chaim David Alevi, Rabbi Shlomo Zalman Orbach, and Rabbi Yosef Blau have spoken out against the practice and or started using coins instead of chickens. And then you don't need a towel." Can we add you to our growing list of Orthodox rabbis who oppose kaparos done with chickens and who support kaparos through tzedakah? Hopefully we will be able to turn this Chilul Hashem is a desecration of God's name, into a Kiddush Hashem, a sanctification of God's name. That was his request. He wanted me to sign on to his website and so forth. So what I want to do is find out, first of all, what exactly is this practice of kaparos, where does it come from? Then talk about why one would do this. What is the meaning behind the practice? What are we trying to gain by doing this? And then to talk about the objections traditionally to it and what rabbis today, in fact, are recommending within the Orthodox community for this. I don't imagine that. You know, much of Toronto actually does this with live chickens. I do know that Chabad has it available for anyone who does want, you know, the opportunity. I personally have never used a chicken live or dead for kaparos. I grew up using money as kaparos. And like I said, saves on the towel. But if you take a look at source number two, you get the basics of the practice there, as recorded by Rabbi Moshe Isserles in the Shulchan Aruch, in the Code of Jewish Law. Now, once I quote you Rabbi Isserles, you already know something is up. Why? See, the Shulchan Aruch, the Code of Jewish Law, is basically an attempt in the 16th century to try to distill debates that have been going on for centuries about what Jewish practice is supposed to be. And it's written by a rabbi by the name of Yosef Karo, who's living in Israel in the city of Tzfat, middle of the 16th century. He's the main author of this book. However, he was originally from Turkey, and now he's living in Israel. So his rulings are going to reflect basically Sephardic practice. Rabbi Moshe Isserles comes along. He is roughly the same generation, a little bit younger, lives in Krakow, and he says, well, us Ashkenazim do some things a little differently, and so he writes what are essentially footnotes to the Code of Jewish Law, and they end up being grafted into the text, so that today, if you look at a book, the Code of Jewish Law, not the abridged version, but the original, you will find Rabbi Karo's statements, and then comments on them from Rabbi Isserles. So, what I'm doing here, by telling you, we're going to look at what the Code of Jewish Law has to say about Kaparos, is, and saying to you, we're going to look at Rabbi Isserles, should lead someone to ask, well, wait a minute, what happened to Rabbi Karo? Why is Rabbi Isserles, who is the second writer, the one who talks about this, and not Rabbi Karo, who preceded him in writing this? So that's a tip already that something is up here. Specifically, Rabbi Karo is not doing kaparos. The Jews in Tzfat in the 16th century are not fans of kaparos. The Jews in Krakow, on the other hand, are. And we're going to talk about why that is. But take a look now at number two. He writes, or Isserles writes, the practice is to take a rooster for a male, a chicken for a female. For a pregnant woman, they take two birds, because you never know. It could be male, it could be female. They choose white birds, as in the verse in Isaiah, if your sins are like red wool, they will become white like snow. The practice is to give the kaparot to the needy. So in other words, you take this chicken, you wave it around the person's head, you shaft it, and then the meat goes to some needy person, and they'll have a meal to eat before Yom Kippur. Sorry? Yeah. Or, he says, to redeem them with money, which is given to the needy. In some places, they also go to visit the cemetery, and they increase giving tzedakah, all of which is a good practice. The slaughter of the kaparot should be immediately after it is passed over him. So in other words, you put it over the person's head, and then you shaft the chicken. And he leans his hands on it like a korban, like a sacrifice, and they throw the innards on the roofs or in the yard where the birds can take them. So that means, yes, it sounds like cannibalism, doesn't it? But the idea is that you're feeding the chicken itself to the needy, and the animals are going to get to eat as well. You are supporting others. That's the idea. Yes?
Rabbi, why is it a chicken that you shook?
Because eagles weren't available.
I never thought of that.
Yeah, she asked why a chicken. But in all truth, it's likely just the available bird. Yeah, I think that's probably the answer. Yeah. Yes.
First of all, that's about this when you do the kaparao,
yeah.
For the male, there are hens and there are roosters.
Yeah.
So the man
uses the rooster. That was what we saw there, yeah.
Yes, but the question is, it's not mentioned in the Torah. How comes we are going into this whole story? Could you please...
You bet. That's where we're going. That's where we're going. As soon as we can. So, there's actually a text to be recited along with this. Okay, so it's like, you know, rubbing your tummy and patting your head at the same time. So while you're doing this, you're reciting a text, much of which comes from Psalms, which I brought you here in source number 3. Verses which speak of people dying, which speak of the shadow of death, which speak of people's guilt, but on the other hand, crying out to God, and God will heal people, God will forgive people for their sins, God will defend people. That's what you see in source number 3. After having recited these verses about forgiveness, then you get the text that's in number 4, in which the person says, this is my exchange. This is my substitute. This is my atonement. This rooster or chicken will die, and I will enter and go to good and long life and to peace. It is actually a substitution of sorts. Some people recite it three times, which makes it three times as good. We have a tradition of repeating certain things three times for, you know, giving it a sense of validity. And then after the circling, again, the bird is shafted and it's given to the needy. Tell me something. This idea of transferring the sin to the chicken, right? This is my replacement. How hungry will you be to eat this bird? Right? I guess it depends on what kind of year you've had. Right? Those who have had, you know, maybe a more sinful year will feel like this chicken is probably less good for them. So if you take a look at source number 5, you actually find this point made by Rabbi Yaakov Molin Maharil. In his writing, and as you see, I gave you the dates there, you're talking end of the 14th century, beginning of the 15th century in Germany, and he says in some places they give the kaparot themselves, meaning the actual chicken, to the needy. The custom of rightness is good to give their monetary equivalent to the needy, so that the pauper will not be ashamed to accept them. When they give the rooster itself, the pauper says, sure, he cast his sins on the rooster, and I'll be graded to him, so he sent it to me.
Yeah.
Like, I should eat his sins. So so that's, you know, an idea of maybe redeeming the bird for cash first. This practice is actually really old. And when I say really old, I brought you a reference in source number 6, and again, you can see the date, the period of the Gaon, 8th century Babylon, a reference to this. Writing to someone who had asked about this practice. As far as your question regarding our practice of slaughtering roosters on Erev Yom Kippur, for which we don't know the reason, if it is a substitute, right, you're substituting for somebody, then why is a rooster different from a domestic or wild animal? Right, it's hard to wave a cow around your head. This certainly is a question. We could offer two reasons. Number one, roosters are more common in the home than domestic or wild animals. We have wealthy people in our area who use rams as substitutes. Right? That's what he says. Then you wonder why Jews have back problems. But then he says the essence is that it is horned, like Yitzchak's ram. Right? The ram that is the substitute for Isaac at the Akedah, at the binding of Isaac. But it's not fixed. It doesn't have to be a rooster, per se. We've also heard from early sages that even though some use animals, which are expensive, a rooster is better because one of the terms we use for rooster in Hebrew is geber, which means a man. So it's actually like a human being. So the practice is actually quite old, but it wasn't even always a bird or a ram, but in fact, some used plants. Take a look at source number 7. Also, an old source. It's a statement of Rashi, the classic commentator from 11th century France, but he is quoting from the period of the Gaonim, which takes us back again, 8th, 9th century. In a response of the Gaonim I found, they made baskets of palm branches, filled them with dirt and animal manure, 22 or 15 days before Rosh Hashanah, each individual makes one for each minor boy and girl in the house, and they plant beans of some kind in them. So they're putting in fertilizer, they're putting in dirt, and then they plant something in it. It grows, and on the day before Rosh Hashanah, each one takes his own and passes it over his head 7 times, saying, this in place of this, this is my exchange, this is my substitute, and he throws it into the river. So it is a bean plant, right? It's like a school project. It's a bean plant instead of a chicken, instead of a ram. Now, the practice, as I said, does continue in some communities today. It's done among Hasidim. It's done among Ashkenazim. Some leaders of the Sephardic community are very much against it, and we're going to come back to that because I mentioned that already, that you see the split in the time in the 16th century, where Rabbi Isserles talks about it in the Shulchan Aruch, but the Rabbi Yosef Karo, the Sephardi, does not. So now that we know what this is, right, we know we have an old practice going back at least 8th, 9th century. We know that some people did this, in fact, with a bird. We know that some people did it with a ram. And we know that some people were doing it with a bean plant. Right? We know as well that the language that's used in this ritual seems to make this, whatever it is, bird, ram, plant, a substitute for the person who is doing the kaparot. In some sense, sin perhaps is being transferred to them. And as noted, We do not have a biblical verse that says do this. We do not have a rabbinic mitzvah that says do this. It doesn't make it into the original Shulchan Aruch, the original code of Jewish law, except in a negative way, which we're going to come to. So, where's the precedent? What is this about? Why did and do Jews do this? Yeah?
Go ahead. Didn't, when the Jews were, I don't know if it was when they're in Egypt or somewhere else, they would send a goat, like, and there's an expression in English, and that was like,
good. So one possible precedent, and it was alluded to a little bit already in one of the sources, is what's called in Hebrew the Sa'ir La'azazel. When the Torah describes the Avodah, the service of the temple on Yom Kippur, it describes a practice which is bizarre. It doesn't fit our standard practice. It's not a korban, it's not a sacrifice, as understood by most commentators. It's called the Sa'ir La'azazel. In English, it's called the... not sacrificial lamb, that's the other piece of it. The scapegoat. It is called the scapegoat. And what happens is, they actually bring two goats, which are supposed to look alike, which is easy for me, because I can't really tell the goats apart. But the goats, the two goats are supposed to look alike. And one of them is brought as a sacrifice to God. And the other one, the Kohen, actually declares, standing by the goats, that the sins of the Jewish people should be upon the goat. He admits, we've sinned, we've erred, and so on. And then the goat is sent off into the wilderness, where it dies. And then the question is, again, what's going on? Are you transferring your sins to the goat? That's the idea of the word scapegoat, right? That's what a scapegoat is. A scapegoat is somebody to blame for all the things that are wrong. So the scapegoat is this creature that's being sent out into the wilderness. Now, that in and of itself, before kafaros, is really, really hard to understand. That ritual is very hard to grasp, and commentators struggle with it because it's not just something that happens once in Egypt. That's actually part of the annual service on Yom Kippur. That's what's supposed to happen. So much so that the Talmud teaches us that in the days of the temple, they would take a ribbon, red ribbon, split it in two parts. One part tied onto the horns of the goat. The other part tied onto a stone in the temple. And people would wash this ribbon. And when the ritual with the scapegoat was complete, the ribbon in the temple would turn white as a sign that we had been forgiven for our sins. So something's up. However, just like I don't understand kaparos, I don't understand the scapegoat. Now, I just have two things to explain, for which I'm grateful, Shana. Now I have two problems. I have succeeded in finding a biblical basis, but I don't understand the biblical basis either. Not only that, there's another potential basis that we noted here that was mentioned, which was the binding of Isaac, the Akedah, right? Abram is called to sacrifice his son, takes the son up to the mountain. Last minute, God says, don't do it. And Abraham finds a ram and brings the ram as an offering. Right? Sorry?
It's like kapara.
In some sense, there's kapara, there's atonement, or there's a substitution, but how does that work? So what would you say? What is the benefit? Now that we understand we may have some precedent for doing so, we still have to ask ourselves, what's the benefit to a person who does this? Why would somebody do this? Judith?
I'm just trying to understand the period of the era.
Yeah.
And somehow the fear of not being fully present in prayer, this is like a guarantee, like if I don't do enough in my prayer, at least I want to make sure that physically I also transfer my...
Right. So Judith offers an interesting idea, which is brought by Rabbi Levi ben Gershom, not regarding kaparos, but regarding korbanos, regarding sacrifices in general, which is, it provides an element of closure. Like, I know I did what I had to do. Prayer, asking for forgiveness, is a very amorphous kind of activity. How do I know when I really ask sincerely? How do I know when I've been forgiven? But if you tell me, here's your ritual, do this, 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 and you're done, then I can do the checklist and I've got completed it. So Ralbah, Rabbi Levi ben Gershom, writes about that as far as the sacrifices, that is meant to give us the opportunity to perform steps and say, okay, now I can move past what I did before. So it's a possibility. You could apply that to Kaparot, I suppose. It does provide that, but it doesn't explain why this ritual as opposed to any other. What else? What benefit could there be for the person who actually does this? Why would somebody be moved to do this? Yeah, Effie.
It's like a meeting of wrongs that fighting.
Right. Good. So one step in approaching this, as he says, is admitting the wrong. I'm repeating it. I'm in the sentence of repeating it. One way to look at it, as he says, is it is an admission of the wrongs that we did. Meaning it can help move a person to apology and atonement. Now, you'll say, but there are ways to do that that don't involve animal cruelty. Right? You can be moved to apologize without that. That's true. Nonetheless, you got to admit, there is a graphic character to this, which really brings home the gravity of somebody's sins. If you take a look at source number 8, Rabbi Jacob Weil, writing in 15th century Germany, and if you're noticing how the sources they keep bringing are Ashkenazi sources, Germany and Poland, right? That's the reason for that. They're the ones who are doing this. So he says, the person who's doing kaparot should contemplate that he is liable for death like this creature. And he says, that's the logic of sacrifices. So the person is supposed to say, I should be experiencing what this is experiencing. Sorry? Sorry? What are you going to say? Okay, but he's saying that's the idea. You look at it as this should be me. We do this in Judaism in a lot of ways, playing on symbolism as something that is supposed to inspire us. It is true that we're taught you're not allowed to be superstitious. You're not supposed to look for omens and the like. But we create signs for ourselves, right? It's a funny experience last Friday. For those of you who listen to the radio, they made a big deal about being Friday the 13th and a full moon.
Yeah.
So I'd be walking out of a building, and there's a workman with a ladder up on a ladder. And I said, do you mind if I walk under the ladder so I can do that on Friday the 13th? But now he probably thinks I believe in those things. No, that was the opposite of what I was doing. But take a look at source number 9, because I think most people here do this. Abaye said from the Talmud, since we say that signs are substantive, one should accustom himself to see gourds, fenugreek, leek, beets, and dates at the start of the year, right? Whether you use these particular foods or not, right? People use apples and honey, people use pomegranate, people take carrots and they slice them up in circles, right? All sorts of practices that people engage in that are meant to be symbols of, in some sense, a good year. So gourds, because gourd in Aramaic is called kira, which we say is like to tear up the bad decree. The dates have a nice, first of all, dates are nice and sweet, so that has a nice element to it. There are all sorts of different explanations for the different items that we have here. I'm not going to go through each one. Apples and honey, of course, are, you know, having a sweet year. But the idea is that we are influenced by that which we see, and this visual experience of seeing what's happening and experiencing what's happening, you're waving around this bird, is going to have an impact. And that's one safe, straightforward explanation for why this would be done. But we have two more explanations to go. Second approach is that it's a transaction. It's a transaction. What you are doing, essentially, is paying for your sins. You did something wrong. Now you're going to take a chicken, and you're going to give it to the needy so that they can eat before Yom Kippur. And what you're doing, really, is giving tzedakah. You are helping those in need. On Yom Kippur, as part of the liturgy, we say, repentance, prayer, and tzedakah, philanthropy, are ways to remove the bad decree. So that's what we are doing. Before you do it, you make a point of saying, this is an act of atonement, by saying, this should carry my sins. That the donation that you're making should carry your sins. In fact, I brought you a number 10, Sean already referenced it, the verse with the scapegoat. The goat shall bear with it all of their sins. It's the idea that You are paying it off. It's a transaction of sorts. It's a strange transaction. But that's the idea. So then, if you take a look at source number 11, Rabbi Yosef's Haim of Baghdad, noted that we call this kaparot. The word lechaper in Hebrew often means to atone. But he said that's not what kaparot means here. Rather, it comes from a related term, which is kofar. Kofar is a term in Hebrew for ransom. So he says, take a look at number 11. The word kaparot is not like kapara, atonement of a carbon, of a sacrifice. Rather, here they call it kaparot, like kofar nefesh, ransom. And he says, according to the secret of these things revealed by the great Arizatzal, who was a leader of mystical thought, you will find this is modeled on the scapegoat, as written in a manuscript edition of Sefer HaKavanot. My mentor was very careful to fulfill the custom of kapara mentioned in the text of the Gaonim, to bind the judgment. The idea being, without getting into too much of the mystical, that this is a matter of paying off the debt incurred by one's sins. So that's a second approach. Anyone here yet convinced they want to weigh the chicken?
No.
Not yet. Not doing it. Okay, let's go to the third and last justification for this. And this, to me, is the most fascinating. It speaks to the way divine judgment operates. It is mystical, but I think it's a very powerful idea. Also modeled on the scapegoat. I think it requires a little bit of an explanation first, though. So here, I'm going to use this nifty marker. This is a different kind of marker. Okay, we got the cap off, that's a step. Right, so far we said that it's about either moving the person to atone, or we said it's about paying a debt with the chicken. But now we get to the third one, and this is different. Most events in life, most of the things that happen in our world, or better than the things, most of the rules by which our world functions, can be broken up into one of two categories. You have rules which are real, and then you have rules which are perceived. And I'll explain what I mean by that. I'm going to go right to the edge of the paper. Real and perceived. When I say real, rules in this world that are real, I'm thinking of things like the laws of physics. Okay? There is a rule which says, roughly, what goes up must come down. If I drop the marker, it's going to hit the floor, right? How many times out of 100 is that going to happen? 100 times out of 100. Physics, it's just a rule. It's the way it is. The weather, right? We may not be able to predict it, but it operates by rules, and the rules are real rules. Health, also, there are certain rules. Again, it's hard to know what's going to happen and when it's going to happen, but fundamentally, there are rules that govern the way the circulatory system works, the way that the respiratory system works, and so on. Those are real rules. It doesn't matter what your personal preferences are. It doesn't matter what your cultural ideals are. We all operate by them, and we don't have a choice. Then you have the rules that are perceived. And what I mean by perceived are conventions. Things that society has decided are the rules by which we are going to function. So in this, I would include law, government legislation, right? There's a law that says in certain areas I'm not allowed to drive more than 50, in certain areas I'm not allowed to drive more than 60, or whatever it is. It's not a law of nature. It's just a rule that we've come up to operate with, and in the event that I exceed that, I may get a ticket, or not, hopefully, but it's simply the law. Manners, right? Manners are perceived rules. They don't actually get enforced, so to speak, by lightning. Right? If you eat with your elbows on the table, right, somebody may get annoyed. But it's a rule that we have developed. And effectively, these rules are binding only to the extent that we honor them. In the event that you have a society in which they say, we don't care about these rules, we do things differently here, then the rule simply ceases to exist. You can't do that with gravity. Right? If Kazakhstan decides we actually not following gravity anymore, right? We wish them luck and we move out of the way. It doesn't work that way. What are the rules of Torah like? Which category does Torah show up in? Is it in the real or is it in the perceived? That's precisely the question. I hear a lot of perceives. Anyone vote for real? Okay, I got a real vote over there. On the one hand, the Torah presents its laws as immutable divine requirements, which makes it sound like it's in the real category. If you steal from somebody, God is going to do something. I don't know what, but something's going to happen. These are the rules that God has set down, and in that sense, they belong in the real category. Something bad will happen if you do bad. Something good will happen if you do good. What it's going to be is up to God, and I don't understand how it works, but that's the way it goes. On the other hand, Judaism softens the impact of these laws because it says things like, the Talmud states, God desires a person's heart. So even if you didn't succeed in doing what you wanted to do, which was good, nonetheless, if your heart was to do the right thing, God is willing to count that. I have another Talmudic passage that says, whether you do more or whether you do less, the essence is that your intent be to serve heaven. I have another Talmudic passage that says that God considers a person's intent to fulfill a mitzvah as though they had actually fulfilled the mitzvah. Right? I was trying to get to shul this morning. There's a 6:30 minyan that I was trying to get to because I had to drive carpool for my daughter. So I wanted to go to the bayit in Thornhill to daven. I got there and the power was out. No one's allowed in the building. So I made it to another shul that had a 6:30 minyan and, you know, missed, you know, the very beginning, the first kaddish that they were saying. Actually, no, I caught the first kaddish. I missed something before. It doesn't matter. The point is, God can look at him and say, look, he did his best, okay? He woke up at 5:40. How much are you going to zap him for here? The point is, God says, I count efforts. I count intent. The law of gravity doesn't count intent. I thought I could fly. That's great. Right? This kind of a statement, while it's wonderfully benign, and it makes us feel better about the times that we fail, seems to put Judaism's law in the category of the perceived, not in the category of the real. If it's in the real, your intent doesn't matter. Along the same lines, we come to Rosh Hashanah, we come to Yom Kippur, and we find out about the idea of Tshuvah, the idea that a person can repent. I've been doing things wrong, but now I'm going to change my ways. I feel bad, and I make a commitment that I'm going to do it differently in the future, and the sin is wiped away. The Talmud even goes so far as to say that if a person repents out of love of God, if they say, I love God and I want to do things better in the future, I'm changing this, then a sin they have performed intentionally in the past can actually be converted to a merit. Not just be wiped away, but turns into a merit. It's considered a good deed now because ultimately it drove them to improve. So, yeah, look at that. Then it sounds like divine decrees are no longer real, they're actually perceived. You follow? They're presented in the Torah as though this is it, this is like gravity. But then we soften it and say, yeah, but you can do tshuva, you can repent, and you'll be forgiven, and you have to mean well, and so forth. Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra says, he's dealing not with kaparos, he's dealing with the issue of the korban, the issue of sacrifice. And he makes the following argument. He says, in the event that somebody sins, a price must be paid. Something is going to have to pay for it. And what he does when he says that is effectively he moves Jewish law back into the real category. He says, even if you're going to be forgiven, Even if God's going to say, you're okay, you meant well, you did your best, your intent was for heaven, you apologized, and therefore you don't have to suffer anything, somewhere this decree has to come true. The lightning's got to hit somewhere. Is Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra's idea regarding sacrifice. And I'm borrowing it here for kaparos, for this idea with the chicken. The idea is, and this is a mystical idea, this is not simple and straightforward, but I think it's a very interesting idea. What it's trying to say is, God, I feel bad, I am repenting, and I want to transfer whatever you were going to do to me. Let it happen instead to the chicken. Let that be the lightning rod, so to speak. When it gets shechted, that takes away what was supposed to, the decree that was supposed to hit me, hits the chicken instead. You follow? So that's a third explanation for kaparos. Three different approaches. Number one approach is, it moves the person who does it to repent. And the idea of doing it with a living creature in particular would be because that will move you to repentance. Swinging money around your head just doesn't cut it. A second approach is, this is your way of paying for your sins, and therefore you can take the chicken and give it to the needy. And then a third approach is this idea from Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra, which is what you're doing is saying, if I did something wrong, there's got to be a price paid, let it be the chicken and not me. That's the idea. And so, historically, there has been a preference for a live creature. I brought you a number 12, Rabbi Yisrael Meir Kagan, writing in Poland 120 years ago, said the later authorities wrote, if there's no rooster, take a goose, good luck, or other creature which is not suitable for the altar, not a korban, and I'll come back to that. And he says, some say even fish. I don't know how you swing a fish over your head. I don't know. I mean, lox maybe, like, you know, take that package. The towel, right, use the towel. Good. However, others have said, let's do money instead. Let's use coins. And granted that it won't really satisfy the first idea of moving you to repentance, unless you need a lot, maybe, you know, then you or move to repentance. But take a look at number 13. Rabbi Avraham Danziger, author of a work of Jewish law called Chaye Adam, he says, in truth, even though several Gaonim recorded this practice, this kaparot practice, still, what is embedded in the heart of the masses is that the entire atonement of Yom Kippur depends on this. People think that this is like the heart of Yom Kippur. Almost as though kaparot and eating matzah were equivalent. Right? Matzah, biblical commandment, very serious. Kaparot, again, just used to be a practice Jews have developed. And they think they have no atonement on Yom Kippur other than with a rooster. And he says, something we're going to come back to. Through this, they come to the sin of nevela, God forbid. What's nevela? Anybody know?
A dead chicken.
A dead chicken, but a chicken that wasn't, sorry. You
know what I'm
saying? Wasn't shafted. Wasn't shafted properly. In other words, what happens, as he says, they push each other in great mobs, the slaughterers are awake all night, in foul moods, no pun intended. I couldn't resist. And they do not sense the blade, meaning, imagine the scene if people are really doing this the night before Yom Kippur, right? Great crowds of people are all there with their chickens, and they're all rushing up to the shochet afterwards and saying, chef this, chef this, chef this. It's at nighttime, it's hard to see, and, you know, the shochet is supposed to be checking his blade, making sure there are no flaws in it, and so on. He says, they end up strafing up the sheep, the bird isn't shefted properly. If they would listen to me, he says, and they don't want to cancel the practice altogether, it would be better for them to wave money around their heads. As it's already embedded in the heart of the ignorant that if they can't acquire a rooster, they should circle money. So he says, they already know that this is an option. For in truth, it is found in early practices, like we read, they used plants. This would be considered righteousness for them, and they would not stumble in the sin of nevela, God forbid. He says, you know, just use coins. Just make it easy. That's his position. So we've seen the reasons to do this. We've seen our three levels here. Now let's go to the other side and the reasons not to do this. There are five. There are three that are objections to the whole practice, and then two that are objections to specifically the use of birds. The first objection to it is, basically, in a nutshell, I don't want to say this lightly, to be glib, but basically this is an absurd practice. That's the first approach. Just philosophically, it is absurd. It's very interesting. In the beginning, I said to you, when I quote you the Code of Jewish Law here, I'm quoting Rabbi Isserlitz. And I said, I didn't quote Rabbi Yosef Karo, who's the primary author. Why didn't I quote him? And the answer is because the section of the Shulchan Aruch, of the Code of Jewish Law, that talks about this practice of kaparot, is actually begun with, there's a heading on it which says, we're going to talk about kaparot, v'hu minhag shtus. I said that specifically Ashkenazi pronunciation because the Hebrew is the Sephardic one is less obvious to people. Minhag shtut would be to say it in Hebrew. But how many people know what shtut is? We know what shtus is. What is shtus? Foolishness. Shtus is something foolish. Rabbi Yosef Karo in his Code of Jewish Law, the heading on that section, it's not clear whether he wrote the headings, but whoever wrote the headings, wrote, this is a custom of foolishness. Or, to quote a predecessor of Rabbi Karo, take a look at source number 14, Rabbi Shlomo Ibn Aderet, a leading Sephardic authority in 13th century Spain. Observers know this is not actually a burnt offering or a peace offering. In other words, this isn't a karban, this isn't a sacrifice. It is just an empty practice altogether. The Aramaic term he uses is, it is havai. Havai means, it is empty. We're not emulating the scapegoat, that's not what this is, and it's something that is simply empty of meaning. That's your first criticism of the practice, is simply that it is, here we go. It is for the birds. Sorry. I got up really early this morning. But that's number one. The second objection to the practice is something that's called in Hebrew, Darchei Emori. Who are the Emorites? Anybody remember? What are the Emorites? The Emori were one of the tribes the Jews met when they arrived in the land of Canaan. And they are associated with all sorts of superstition and idolatry biblically. And if you take a look at source number 15, Rabbi Yosef Karo himself, primary author of the Code of Jewish Law, says, the practice of performing kapara on Erev Yom Kippur, slaughtering a rooster for every male and reciting verses, one should prevent this practice. He was very clear. He was not vague in this. He says, this is what we call Darchei Emori, this is what we call a pagan practice. That's the way the commentators understood this this idea. Rashba, Rabbi Shlomo Ibn Aderet, who I mentioned, Ramban, Nachmanides as well. The only question is, what do you mean when you say that it is in fact a practice of pagans, right? What pagans were swinging chickens around their heads? Which pagan are you blaming for this practice? So, that's a good question. If you take a look at source number 17, Rashba, Rabbi Shlomo Ibn Aderet, who I quoted already in number 14, is saying that it's an empty practice. He says, I have found the practice has spread in our city with other similar practices. They slaughter an old rooster for kapara, for a newborn. They hang the head with its feathers over the doorway with garlic. Many empty practices which appear to me as the paths of the Emori. And I have pushed heavily against this. And with divine favor, my words were heard, and none of this and the like remains in our city. Nobody's doing this anymore. I have obliterated it because it is a pagan practice, he says. So I went looking to find if there were any pagans who actually did this. So take a look at source number 18, where I found the funny, I found it to be very funny anyway. From a book called Curiosities of Superstition. It was on Halloween, or All Hallows Eve, the evening of the 31st of October, that superstition ran riot in Celtic society. Because on that particular evening, the supernatural influences of the other world were supposed to be especially prevalent. The power of divination was likewise believed to be at its height. Apples are a relic of the old Celtic fairy lore. They are thrown into a tub of water. You endeavor to catch one in your mouth as they bob round and round in provoking fashion, bobbing for apples. When you have caught one, you peel it carefully and pass the long strip of peel thrice, sunwise, around your head. After which you throw it over your shoulder and it falls to the ground in the shape of the initial letter of your true love's name. Isn't that sweet? So you can do two things. You can do apples and honey with bobbing for apples, and you can also do kaparos, apparently, at the same time. I have not been able to find anything further along these lines. However, this is indeed a second objection, and in particular, we noted before that some prefer a white bird because white is a sign of forgiveness and atonement. That really raises the objection from various rabbis to say, this really looks like some kind of weird pagan thing, and it's not something that we do. So that's your second objection, is that it looks pagan. And then there's a third objection. And the third objection is an interesting one. Let me take you back to the Passover Seder. Towards the end of the section called Magid, where we tell the story of leaving Egypt, we get to Rabban Gamliel. And we have a passage where Rabban Gamliel says, you have to say three things at your Seder, or you didn't fulfill your obligation. Exactly. Pesach, Matzah, Maror. Right? When you say the Matzah paragraph, when you describe why you do Matzah, what do? People pick up the Matzah. Yeah. When you get to the Maror paragraph, people pick up the Maror. Right? Roman lettuce, horseradish, whatever it is that they're using. Right? But when they say the Pesach paragraph, my Haggadah says, don't even point to the Zerua, the shank bone that's on the Seder plate. Anybody know why? Because the original Pesach offering is a sacrifice for God. And if you look like you are identifying this as a korban, then it has to be dedicated to God. No one's allowed to eat it, no one's allowed to benefit from it. Has to be treated in special ways. You're not allowed to dedicate things to the temple. Well, the concern here is if you really are building this on the scapegoat, right, then it looks like you're dedicating this creature as a sacrifice, which would mean that you couldn't give it to the needy to eat. So a third problem is it looks like consecration. That's why one of the sources we read before said don't use a creature that can be used as a korban, as a sacrifice, because you don't want it to look like consecration, which would mean it's now off limits. So that's a technical objection. We have three objections so far. First of all, it looks absurd. Second of all, it looks pagan. And third of all, you could end up dedicating a sacrifice if you're not careful. The fourth objection is the one we've already seen, which is Nevela, you ruin the Shechita, you ruin the slaughter because they're mobs of people at night. You end up with treif, which again, you're supposed to be feeding this to needy people. You go to them and give them your treif bird to eat on Erev Yom Kippur. That's nice. Thank you very much. And then the last objection is probably the first one in many people's minds, which is what's called in Hebrew Tsar Balei Chayim. Right? Exactly. Cruelty to animals. This poor bird you wrapped up in the towel. Right? Or fish, for that matter. We have in Judaism a very important principle of avoiding taming animals. Even in the course of what people normally consider standard interactions. Take a look, please, at source number 19. Story from the Talmud about Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi, who was the leading scholar as well as the leading political figure for the Jews living in Israel in the beginning of the 3rd century Common Era. A calf was being brought for slaughter. It hit its head under Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi's garment. It was crying. Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi said, go, you were created for this. In heaven, they said, since he does not have mercy, let suffering befall him. And as the story goes, he suffers miserably with stomach pains and bowel problems for years and years. One day, Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi's maid was sweeping out the house. She swept out some rodents. Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi said to her, leave them be. For it is written, his mercy is upon all of his creations. God is merciful for all. And in heaven they said, since he displayed mercy, we will have mercy upon him. How many people have mercy on the mice if they find mice in their house, right? The calf is a lot more sympathetic, no? Nonetheless, that's the statement. In another statement, source number 20, Rabbi Yehuda taught, quoting Rav, one may not eat until he has first fed his animal. Because the biblical verse says, I will put grass in your field for your animal, and you shall eat and be sated. First the animal eats, and then you eat. This is a major tenet in Judaism, that we must protect animals from pain. And especially today, when you have this problem of mass commercialization, I'm not going into, you know, factory farming and all of that, but you can end up being extremely cruel on a time when we're supposed to be merciful. So that if you take a look at number 21, my last source here, Rabbi Chaim David Halevi, a rabbi in Israel in the middle of the 20th century, wrote at length about this. He said, although the Torah permits slaughter to eat meat, and even this is not ideal, why increase slaughter that is not for food? It is known that the slaughter on Erev Yom Kippur for Kaparot, for the number of people in the home, is great and massive. They eat from it until Sukkot. So he says, you're slaughtering much more than people need on the eve of Yom Kippur. And do we need to do this on the eve of a holy day specifically, to be cruel to creatures entirely unnecessarily, to butcher them mercilessly at a time when we stand to seek life for ourselves from the living God? There is proof to this, to his position, from the responsa of Mahari, Rabbi Yehuda Asad, I think was his last name, I'm not 100% sure, who wrote a book called Yehuda Yahaleh, who said the practice is not to slaughter on the Yom Tov of Rosh Hashanah, meaning technically one could slaughter an animal on Rosh Hashanah, if they're going to use it for eating. On Shabbat, you're not allowed to slaughter an animal. On Yom Tov, on holidays, you would be allowed to. He says, technically you may, but we don't do that. For each slaughter includes pain for creatures, just as the Torah permits it. And on the day of judgment, when all of us seek mercy all day, it is written, his mercy is upon all of his deeds. It is appropriate that we do nothing cruel actively to slaughter creatures. And so all of the slaughterers and examiners said the custom throughout Israel is not to slaughter on the Yom Tov of Rosh Hashanah. End of quote. This is a logical, I'm jumping the parentheses. This is a logical point. Even on the Yom Tov of Rosh Hashanah, when slaughter is for eating, and it even fulfills the mitzvah of joy on Yom Tov, even still it is appropriate not to perform a cruel deed of slaughter on this day, the Day of Judgment, certainly Erev Yom Kippur. When the goal is not eating, right, your goal is forgiveness, it is inappropriate to be cruel upon creatures unnecessarily, and so he flipped to flip the page. Therefore, I have hinted at the suggestion in the note you identified in your question, he's writing to someone who asked him about this, that the early practice of performing kaparot with palm baskets would be better in my eyes than slaughter of kaparot. That's what I meant, to prevent pain of creatures and acts of cruelty on the eve of the holy day. To me, it would be good and appropriate to cancel this practice entirely in accord with the ruling of the Shulchan Aruch, Rabbi Karo. But if someone's heart troubles him and he sees in this practice payment for his life and the lives of his household, he could fulfill practice with money, like the Chaye Adam's words that we read. So that today, in practice, yeah.
My question is, how many years did the court go down before they decided that this was inhumane?
Right. It's a good question, and the answer seems to be you have objections going on from the beginning. Animal rights is a new thing in the secular world, you know, maybe in the last century. But in the Jewish world, these objections were going on all along. That's why you see the money, that's why you see the plans. The objections in the Jewish world are not new. The thing is, what you're looking at is a practice that has three concrete benefits that they're identifying. Moving a person to repentance, number one. Paying for one's sins by giving this chicken, number two. And number three, saying I'm deflecting the divine decree. So that's what gives it the inertia, or the momentum, really, that the practice has, and that's why it continues. But it's a hard one. I see I have 2 minutes left, so I want to just make sure that I get to the end here. There is a strong opposition to this practice, as I mentioned already in the beginning. I got that email with a list of rabbis who are against it, but many communities do continue to do it. Within the Orthodox community, it is very controversial. I know nothing about about other communities. But it really is controversial. But many people do what I've been doing all my life, which is to just use money. But I don't want to lose sight of the broader point. Regardless of whether one performs kaparot or how one performs kaparot, we should recognize the three levels of benefit in our own approach to the high holidays. Some people are mystical in their orientation, and they say, you know what, God, I understand that I've done things that are wrong, and that something's gonna happen, but I'm asking you, God, don't let this affect me, let it, you know, have some kind of a less harmful effect. Some people are transactional. They approach the high holidays and say, God, I know I've done things that are wrong, and I'd like to make it right, and I'm going to donate to tzedakah. I'm going to do something to pay off that which I've done. And some people are simply motivated spiritually and say, I want to be inspired to grow out of my failures and to right my wrongs. These three pieces of it are really important and should not be lost in the difficulty we have in understanding kaparot. So I hope that all of us will at least take the motivations, the positive motivations of kaparot, and use them for ourselves on the high holidays, and God willing, we'll be blessed with a happy and healthy new year. Thank you.